Good morning, everyone. We're glad that you're here today. Let me make sure I turn my microphone on. I think I did. Yes, I did. Good morning. Glad to see everybody here today. Happy Valentine's Day. We just talked about that a moment ago. Happy birthday tomorrow to Jessica, and happy past birthday to Heather. And we're glad that you're here, though. It's been a couple of weeks since we've been able to have in-house, in-church worship service because of the weather. But we're glad that we're able to meet together today, even though it's cold outside still. At least there's no big snow and no ice today. It's our prayer that during this month, that as we celebrate birthdays and Valentine's Day, that each of us actually really feel the love, that you are loved by this church, as well as by our Heavenly Father. Last week during our virtual service, if you were able to watch that, I introduced the theme for the month as loving like Jesus loved. And we're going to continue that theme throughout the month of February. And I'm going to again read for us from 1 John chapter 4. The first part of it will sound familiar because that was last week's call to worship, but I'm going to read that in addition to the other verses down through verse 21. 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 21. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. We know that we live in him and he in us because he has given us his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in him and he in God. And so we know and rely on the love that God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him. In this way, love is made complete among us so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment, because in this world we are like him. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. If anyone says, I love God, yet hates his brother, he is a liar. For anyone who does not love his brother, whom he has seen, cannot love God, whom he has not seen. And he has given us this command, whoever loves God must also love his brother. Let us pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you thanking you for this day that you have given us. We thank you for the many blessings of life that you bestow upon us. We thank you for the opportunity to be in your house and to worship you today. And Father, I pray that we will be able to live out this passage in our daily lives, that because we do love you, we love one another. We love our brothers and sisters in Christ. We love our community. We love our church. Father, we pray that we can show our love in all aspects of our life, just as Jesus showed his love for us in going to the cross and dying in our place. Father, as we come together to worship today, I pray that we would each be encouraged and uplifted and edified. But above all, Lord, we pray that you are glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
morning. Good to see each of you here this morning. I do have a couple of cards. The first one says, thank you for your words of sympathy, your voice of concern, your gesture of caring, and the love you offer. Thank you so very much for everything during the loss of Papa. We love each and every one of you, the Lewis and Melton family. And then I also have a card from Beverly Thomas, thanking the church for the donation to Johnson in Jim's name. And she goes on to tell about the stuff that's going on with her. So I will post this on the bulletin board so each of you could read. As we come to a time of prayer, we do have several names that are on the prayer concerns. Are there any names that we need to mention this morning?
Update on Kim Parsons. She did have her PET scan, and the cancer has spread throughout her body. She is going this week for radiation treatment on her left side to help reduce the pain. There really isn't a lot that they can do at this point, but they are going to try to help with the pain. Also, we want to keep Jamie Smith in our prayers. He had posted on Facebook that he's been having some low heart rate problems, and he had a monitor. He's taken that back, and they're looking at that and possibly have to take it back.
Okay. And just keep Joel and Delana Hill in your prayers also. They had their second shots, and both of them had some minor reactions, but they are doing better. But please keep them in your prayers. Are there any other names we need to mention this morning?
Continue to keep Justin's uncle, Kenny Marion, in your prayers. They have moved him to Grayson Health and Rehab.
Okay. All righty. Any other names we need to mention? Let's go to God in prayer. Father God, we just thank you for the day that you've given us. And Father, we just thank you so much for this opportunity that we have together in your house to worship you. Father, we know that we are few in numbers, but Father, we just pray to be with each one that is here and also the ones that could not make it. And Father, we just pray your blessings be upon them. Father, there's so much sickness and hurting in this world. And Father, we just pray for each and every one that's dealing with the coronavirus. And Father, we just pray your healing touch be upon each and every one of them. And Father, we ask that you be with this nation and help us to go in the way that you want us to go. And Father, we just pray you'll be with leadership, this state, this county, and all this church. And Father, be with us, lead us and guide us, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
most of your wedding ceremonies, there's a time that's set aside for the exchanging of rings. And during this time, sometimes the minister will say, though small in size, these rings are large in significance. Made of precious metal, they remind us that love is not cheap, not common. Indeed, love may cost us dearly. Made in a circle, their design tells us that love must never come to an end. We must keep it continuous. As you wear these rings, whether together or apart for a moment, they may be constant reminders of this glad promises that you've made. And this is from the Christian Minister's Manual, 1984. Okay, good. Yes, in spite of its size, the ring conveys a large significance to a husband and a wife. As true with the wedding ring, the importance of these emblems of the Lord's Supper is not on their size. In fact, let us consider how the words above, or the words I just wrote, could be altered somewhat and applied to the Lord's Supper. Though it's small in size, these emblems are large in significance. Both of these emblems were obtained at a price. Grains of wheat had to be crushed to make the bread. Grapes had to be broken and crushed to make this juice. These emblems remind us that our salvation was purchased at a price. God's love is not cheap nor common. Indeed, his love cost the life of his only son. And so as we take these emblems today, I hope it reminds us of the love that Jesus had for us and our responsibility to serve him faithfully, knowing that he died that we may live. Let us pray. Father God, we come around the table now whenever we remember the sacrifice of your son on that cross. And we know what great love you have for your son and how hard it must have been to send him to die for our iniquities. Father, we thank you for this sacrifice. And as we remember that, we ask that you forgive us when we've fallen short and help us to grow stronger in you. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread, blessed it and broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said, take eat, this is my body. In like manner, he took the cup, saying, this cup is new covenant. Do this whenever you do it in remembrance of me.
Our Father God, we come to you once again thanking you for the opportunity to be in your house and to worship you and to sing our songs of praise and to partake around the Lord's table and to remember the sacrifice that you made so long ago, but still was so needed today. Father, I also ask that you would bless the offerings of this church, those given here as well as those that are mailed in. Father, we're thankful for the continued commitment of our people, and we ask your blessing upon both the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Yeah.
Isn't that a great song? The words just really spoke to me when I read them the other day. And thank you all for sharing that with us today. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, I want to encourage you to turn to Matthew chapter 5, verses 43 through 48. As I said before, as we continue our series, Loving Like Jesus Loved. And today's title is similar to that, to the overall theme, Loving Like Your Father Loves, Loving Like God Loves Us. I ran across this poem. I'd seen it before, but ran across it again this week, and I think it really speaks to today. It's really relevant. There once were two cats from Kilkenny. Each thought there was one cat too many. They fought and they spit, they clawed and they bit, till instead of two cats, there weren't any. You know, hatred is such a strong thing in our world today. And as Christians, we are taught that hatred is not a good thing. We are not to hate. But in Jesus' day, there was actually some who had the saying, hate those who hate you. In fact, they could go back into the Old Testament and find a biblical foundation for that concept, because in Psalm 139, verses 21 through 22, it says, David says, do I not hate those who hate you, Lord? And abhor those who rise up against you. I have nothing but hatred for them. I count them my enemies. And in addition to that, there are some people that seem to have some logical reasons to hate others. Some time ago, there was a man by the name of Bob Brody who wrote this in a Reader's Digest article. I've discovered that nothing feels quite as satisfying as a grudge well nursed. I had a boss who took a dislike for me from my first day on the job, even though she had hired me. There were no complaints about my performance, but I later learned that she talked to other co-workers about me, lied to them. Without explanation, she laid me off only 10 weeks before Thanksgiving. I had a family to support. Was I to forgive her? Should I? Give me one good reason, he wrote. My grudge against her balanced out that injustice and somehow righted the universe. It has kept me warm on a many a cold night. A long-standing grudge suggests that, he says, that we hold certain standards and that we respect ourselves enough to reject bad behavior. Failure to forgive can be just as righteous and honorable as forgiveness itself. I suspect that there are a lot of Bob Brodies in our world today just by watching the news and listening to people talk sometimes. They feel well justified in hating their enemies and in not forgiving because, number one, it shows that they have high standards. Number two, it shows they respect themselves. And number three, they refuse to accept bad behavior. They believe that hating their enemies makes them righteous and honorable, even godlike. And you know what? That was actually the mindset of the religious community in Jesus' day. Love your neighbors and hate your enemies, they thought. And if you do that, you'll be like God. But then along came Jesus, and he said, now hold on a minute. Wait a second. That's not right. That's not true. In fact, in Matthew chapters 5 through 7, Jesus turned a lot of people's thinking upside down with his Sermon on the Mount. And right in the midst of his Sermon on the Mount, in Matthew chapter 5, verses 43 through 48, Jesus says this, You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your brothers, what are you doing more than others? Do not even the pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Recently, I saw a list of three reasons why we ought to love our enemies. Number one, it's cheaper than hiring a lawyer. Number two, it decreases the likelihood that you'll end up a guest on the Jerry Springer Show. And number three, and most importantly, because Jesus said so. Jesus said, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. How hard of a thing is that to do? Again, to the world, this doesn't make sense, but in reality, it doesn't have to make any sense. All we have to know is that this is what God wants us to do. In fact, we would do well to memorize Isaiah chapter 55, verses 8 through 11, which says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts." And then it continues on, "As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish so that it yields seed for the sower and bread to the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I have sent it." When we think about that verse and what God says about His ways are not our ways, His thoughts are not our thoughts, and He talks about my word going out from my mouth, right here is God's word. These are His words. The words in this book doesn't just contain God's word. A lot of people think that it contains God's word, but it's not necessarily all of God's word. I believe with all of my heart that this book is God's word, every single word. The Apostle Paul wrote in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 15 through 17, he wrote to Timothy saying, "From infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work." And then Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says, "For the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, penetrating even to the dividing of both the soul and the spirit and joints and the marrow, and able to discern the thoughts and the intentions of our heart." Again, a lot of people look at what's in this book and they think, man, that doesn't make sense. But in reality, it doesn't have to make sense. All I have to know is what is contained in this word, in this book, is what God wants us to do. There's an old saying that says, the Bible says it, I believe it, that settles it. Well, actually, that's only partially true. The truth is, the Bible says it, that settles it. Whether or not I want to believe it or not, the Bible says it, that settles it. And the Bible has a lot to say when it comes to loving our enemies. Loving our enemies has been God's will, even in the Old Testament. Even though, you know, people of old have taken the Bible out of verses out of context even back to Jesus' day. But even in the Old Testament, God still wanted his people to love their enemies. In Exodus chapter 23, verses 4 through 5, God told his people, if you come across your enemy's ox or donkey wandering off, be sure to take it back to him. If you see the donkey of someone who hates you falling down under its load, do not leave it there. Be sure to help him with it. In Proverbs chapter 25, verses 21 and 22, we are told, if your enemy is hungry, give him food. If he is thirsty, give him water to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals upon his head, and the Lord will reward you. And that command is repeated again in the New Testament in Romans chapter 12, verse 20, telling us as Christians that God has not changed his mind. God still wants us to love our enemies and pray for those who persecute us. I've discovered that there, by studying this passage in Matthew chapter 5, verses 43 through 48, that Jesus actually gives us three reasons why we should love our enemies. The first reason we should love our enemies is because it's in our own best interest to do so. Look again at what Jesus says there in verse 46. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? In Luke chapter 6, verses 27 through 36, Jesus preached basically the same message as he does here about loving our enemies, as he does here in Matthew chapter 5. But there in chapter 6, he says, I tell you who hear me, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. If someone strikes you on one cheek, turn to him the other also. If someone takes your cloak, do not stop him from taking your tunic also. Give to everyone who asks you, and if anyone takes what belongs to you, do not demand it back. Do to others as you would have them do to you. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who are good to you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners do that. And if you lend to those from whom you expect payment, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners, expecting to be repaid in full. But love your enemies, he says. Do good to them, and lend to them without expecting to get anything back, and then your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High, because he is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. Be merciful just as your Father is merciful. God knows how difficult it is to love our enemies and to pray for those who persecute you. So he specifically makes a promise to us that he will reward us for making that effort. And what is that reward? Well, according to one resource that I read, people who do not forgive the wrongs that are committed against them tend to have higher rates of divorce, experiences more stress, have more depression, and suffer from more cardiovascular disease, strokes, and heart attacks. But by contrast, as a group, people who do forgive the wrongs that are committed against them tend to have less depression. They have more friends and family to support them. In fact, forgiving people are better at making friends than those who carry grudges. And that last one really makes sense, doesn't it? Because people who don't forgive, people who hold grudges, people who dwell on the wrongs that are done to them, don't make very pleasant companions. They're extremely unhappy and they're extremely difficult to be around. So forgiveness is good for us. It is indeed a physical reward that we receive by loving our enemies. But as the old saying goes, but wait, there's more. There's more to this reward than just physical benefits. 2 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 9 tells us that the eyes of the Lord range throughout the earth to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to Him. I had never thought about that verse until this week, and I ran across it. The eyes of the Lord range throughout the earth to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to Him. In other words, God is looking to reward those who obey Him, especially in this topic of loving our enemies and praying for those who persecute us. God is looking to strengthen us and to bless us and to reward us and to actively work in our lives to do good things, all because He knows how difficult this is, loving our enemies, praying for those who persecute us. So Jesus teaches us that we should love our enemies because it is in our own best interest. The second reason that we should love our enemies is because in doing so, we show the world that we are not like the pagans. Look again at verse 47. If you greet only your brothers, what are you doing more than others? Do not even the pagans do that? Now that word pagans simply means Gentiles. Literally, the word is for tax collector or publican. Now, let's think about that for a minute. The Bible teaches us that once we become a Christian, we belong to Jesus, right? Once we become a Christian, we belong to Jesus. So, who do we belong to before we become a Christian? That's right, Satan. You didn't say it, but I heard you thinking it. Here's the deal. Before I became a Christian, I did belong to Satan. I used to be a soldier for Satan. I learned to live my life the way that Satan would have me to live my life. When I got mad, I got mad like Satan would get mad. When I fought fights, I fought my fights like Satan would fight his fights. Satan is a hater of his enemy. He hates God and he hates us because we are made in God's image. How does Satan fight? He's the accuser of the brethren, the followers of God. He's the destroyer of everything that God holds precious. Satan hates, hates, and hates some more. And he teaches his followers to hate. And when we hate our enemies, we belong to him. We end up living as the pagans do, or the publicans do, or the tax collectors do, as the Gentiles do. But Jesus says, don't be like that. Don't be like those people. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 20, the Apostle John writes, if anyone says, I love God, yet hates his brother, he is a liar. For anyone who does not love his brother, whom he has seen, cannot love God, who he has not seen. Galatians 5, verses 19 through 21, warns us that if we're going to live like real Christians live or ought to live, we need to understand that the acts of the sinful nature are obvious. And amongst those sinful acts is hatred and discord and jealousy and fits of rage and selfish ambition and dissensions and factions. We don't normally think about those things as being big sins. But notice what Paul says there in verse 21. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. And then he goes on to say in verses 22 through 25, but the fruit of the Spirit
is, and he begins that list of the fruits of the Spirit with love. As Christians, we cannot allow ourselves to fall back into the living the way that we did when we were in the world, when we were children of Satan. As Christians, to allow ourselves to hate our enemies is to live the way that Satan would have us to live. It's to go back to living the kind of life that we lived before we knew Christ. As Christians, we are called to live differently in this world. In Romans 12, verse 2, do not conform any longer to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. 1 Peter 1, verse 14, as obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires that you had when you lived in ignorance. In Matthew 5, verses 14 through 16, the passage just up from where we're studying today, Jesus said to his followers, you are the light of this world. Now think about that. You are the light of the world. This world in which we are living is growing darker and darker and darker in its hatred for one another every single day. I believe with all of my heart, as a follower of Christ, as a believer of His Word, that as Christians, we need to begin doing a better job of dispelling that darkness with the light that shines through us, Jesus Christ. As Christians, we can dispel the darkness of this world by loving even our enemy and praying for those who would persecute us. And we need to begin to lift high the light of our love. Jesus said, you are the light of this world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. A well-lit city up on a hilltop will beckon people out of the darkness. Let us, as God's lighthouse, as His lighthouse today, His lighthouse of love, let's begin drawing people out of their darkness of hatred. I still find myself singing that children's song that we learned when we were little kids. I learned it going to vacation Bible school. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Don't listen to my singing. Listen to the words. But you know, I'm going to let it shine all the time. Let it shine. All around the neighborhood, I'm going to let it shine. Hide it under a bushel. No, I'm going to let it shine. Not going to let Satan it out. I'm going to let my little light shine. We need to live that every single day. Let my little light shine. We may think we just have a small flame, but have you ever been in total darkness and just strike a match, light a candle? How much light that puts off? That's what we can do as well in this world of darkness. Jesus said in Matthew 5, verse 16, let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. And one of the ways that we do that is by loving our enemies and praying for those who persecute us. Because in so doing, we show the world that we're different. The third reason that we should love our enemies is because in doing so, we prove that we are children of the Most High God. Verse 45, Jesus says, love our enemies and pray for those who persecute us, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. Remember that passage in Luke that I read, chapter 6, verse 36, says, and you will be sons of the Most High. That's what I want to be. I want to be considered the son of our Father in heaven, the son of the Most High God. But like I said earlier, when we hate our enemies, when we hate one another, we're not sons of the Most High. We're children of Satan. When we love our enemies and we pray for those who persecute us, we are most emulating God at that time. John 3:16-18. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. In Romans 5:6-11, Paul writes, "You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, when we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation." How many of us really have thought long and hard about what Paul writes there? Before you and I became Christians, we were God's enemies. In fact, Ephesians 2:3 tells us that at that time, we were actually objects of wrath. Ephesians 2:1-7 reads, "As for you, you were dead in your transgression and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in his mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus." So we were God's enemies. We were objects of his wrath. And if God had not so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, we would all be doomed to hell. But praise be to God, he did love us, so loved us that he gave his Son. And he did that even yet when we were still sinners, when we were still his enemies. In fact, God cares so much for mankind that he does not withhold at any time the most basic of blessings. Look again at what Jesus says in verse 45. "He," our Heavenly Father, "causes his Son to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous." Now, if it were up to me, if I were God, only the good and the righteous would receive rain and sunshine. The evildoers could stand out, and the unrighteous could stand out in a cold desert somewhere. They could chirp for sun and rain all that they want, but they wouldn't get it if that were me. But God isn't me. Praise God, he's not me. God's not like that. Why? Because 2 Peter 3:9 tells us that he is patient, not want anyone to perish, but for everyone to come to repentance. You see, people who hate their enemy play God. They want to be the celestial enforcers. They want to be the powerful destroyers that squash the evil that is their enemy. And they feel most God-like as they lay awake at night considering the many terrible ways that they would destroy those that they hate if only they had the power. But that's not what God is like. God wants everyone to be saved. He is patient, not wanting anyone to perish. And if we really want to be God-like, if we really want to love the way that God loves, then we need to come to the realization that playing God means that we need to forgive our enemies. Just the way that the real God, our Heavenly Father, the Most High God, has forgiven us. The Apostle Paul wrote in Ephesians 4, verse 32, "Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as Christ, as in Christ, God forgave you." Jesus said in Matthew 6, verses 14 and 15, "If you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, then your Father will not forgive you of your sin." Several years ago, the Voice of Martyrs published a powerful story about an African boy by the name of Damar. Damar was a slave who had angered his Muslim master by attending a Christian worship service. And so his owner took him out, Damar, out into the wilderness, nailed his feet and his knees to a board, and left him there to die. And he would have died had not someone found him and nursed him back to health. And in his interview with the Voice of Martyrs, Damar said that he had forgiven the person who had done that to him. When asked why, how could he forgive such an evil thing done to him? Damar said, "Because Jesus was nailed to the cross and he has forgiven me." That young man knew what it was to be like his father. That young man forgave as God had forgiven him when Jesus Christ was nailed to the cross. But when we refuse to forgive our enemies, we become more like our enemies than we do God. And we actually end up hurting Jesus more, the one who died for us on the cross. I once read a story, and I'll close with this. I once read a story about a Sunday school class where a teacher was known for his elaborate object lessons. Once he placed a large target up on the bulletin board, and on a nearby table he placed some darts. And he told his students that morning that he wanted them to draw a picture of someone that they greatly disliked or somebody who had made them angry, and he would allow them to throw darts at the pictures that they drew. Well, one girl drew a picture of another girl who had stolen her boyfriend. Someone else drew a picture of his little brother. One even drew a picture of the teacher. When they were finished with their drawings, the class lined up and they began throwing the darts. And everybody was having a great time, having a lot of fun. Some of the students even threw the darts so hard that they absolutely shredded their pictures. And after everybody had taken their turn, the teacher began removing the pictures from the target. And then he took down the target. And behind the target was a picture of Jesus. And he simply ended the class by speaking these words, "Inasmuch as you have done it unto the least of these brethren of mine, you have done it to me." Here's the deal. Loving our enemy can be tough. Most of the time, it's a painful experience filled with emotional feelings. We feel as though a lot of times that it's an impossible task. But God, Jesus Christ, gives us the very resources that we need to do what He asks us to do. It is not on our forgiveness
any more than on our own goodness that the world's healing hinges, but upon His. And when He tells us to love our enemies, He gives us, along with the command, the love itself to extend. That's indeed God's promise. If we will seek to honor Him in loving our enemies, He will supply what is needed. But in order for us to have this power to love our enemies, we must receive God's love first of all. We do that by believing in His Son as our Savior, by repenting of our sins and making the effort to live a godly life, by confessing His name publicly, to let people know that we are His, and by being baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of our sins and for the gift of the Holy Spirit. Our song of decision this morning is How Deep the Father's Love. If you have never made a decision to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord, I invite you just now as we stand and as we sing, or reach out to me at some other point if you don't feel comfortable in coming today. But reach out to me. Make that decision for God today. And make that commitment to love your enemies and to pray for those who persecute you. Let's stand. How deep the Father's love.
How deep the Father's love.
Thank you.
Again, good to see everybody here, especially good to see Sharon with us, visiting with us today. We don't get many visitors during this season of pandemic, but it's good to have you worshiping with us today. And at this time, I'm going to ask Alan if he would close us in prayer, and then we'll sing our scripture blessing.
Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we wish to thank you so much for allowing us to attend church today. We wish to thank Kent for all he's done in bringing the YouTube videos, the stuff that's been distributed to all the people. No one knows just how much work it goes into that. But what's missing from them is the emotion that you get of attending church in person, to feel the emotion and to feel the presence of God. Father, we ask it that you be with us during this time of troubles in our country, in this time of our pandemic. And Father, please, all the people that are scared, know that you are there for them. Father, be with us as we go forth, make our actions influence someone else to attend church to further life over to Christ. Father, forgive us of all our sins and shortcomings. Be with us, go with us, and bless us. And in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace.
God bless you. Have a great week.